The age of gene therapy is at hand. The era of age-related disease is over. And now that I have your attention, I'd like to ask you a couple of questions. So one, what is disease? It's something that makes you sick and tries to kill you, right? So two, what is old age? It's something that makes you sick and tries to kill you, right? So is old age a disease? Yep, you bet. That's exactly what it is.
Health and medicine, we talked about our bodies, and our bodies are basically actually information because it's governed by our genes, their information processes. We didn't used to treat it that way. It was basically hit or miss. We'd find something, oh, here's something that lowers blood pressure, here's something that kills HIV, and we'd find these things accidentally. So progress was linear. Still valuable. I gave a speech to 12 and 13-year-old science winners recently, and I said you all would be senior citizens if it hadn't been for this progress, because life expectancy was 19 a thousand years ago. But this is going to go into high gear now. The enabling factor for health and medicine to become an information technology was the Genome Project. That itself was a perfect exponential. And we now have the software of life, and we're also making exponential progress in being able to model it, simulate it, understand it, and reprogram it. And I can speak at great length about examples of how we're doing that. You can, for example, now fix a broken heart, not yet from romance, that'll take a few more developments in virtual reality, but from a heart attack. Amy's grandfather, my father, had a heart attack in the 60s. There was nothing you could do about it. He could hardly walk. But I've talked to people now who could hardly walk and are now rejuvenated. You actually have to be a medical tourist and go to a place like Israel. But it's just one example of many. And what is now a sort of a trickle of these developments is going to be a flood. 10 years from now, these technologies will be 1,000 times more powerful than they are today because they're doubling in power every year. They'll be 1,000,000 times more powerful in 20 years. We'll reach a point 10 to 20 years from now, probably closer to 10, where we're adding more than a year every year, not just to infant life expectancy, but to your remaining life expectancy.
Is there a disease that you fear most? Maybe cancer, diabetes, Alzheimer's, heart disease, or something else? 100,000 people will die today of some age-related disease. That is more than 36 million per year. As this video will show you, it doesn't have to be that way. Gene therapy breakthrough, ending age-related disease, is about living, not dying. If you are young, healthy, and happy, then when would be a good time to die?
So I'm going to go ahead and start here with this very funny comic. So this guy is saying, I eat right, I exercise, I don't drink or smoke, but I'm still going to die someday. That changes everything. Why would I bother? Why would I bother doing all of these things if I'm just going to die?
Liz Parrish, She is a person who lives the definition of awesome. She works boldly and tirelessly because she wants to help make a better planet for all of us to share. She uses her full-throttle intellect to make the impossible happen. She is CEO of BioViva Science. She and her colleagues are sitting on some top-shelf gene therapies that will set humankind free of unnecessary suffering and premature death. She don't just think outside the box. She thrives there. With Liz at the helm, life is going to get really good really fast. So we may as well get ready for it.
So, hi, my name's Liz Parrish, and I'm the CEO of BioViva, and I'm an entrepreneur and a humanitarian. I'm not a scientist, essentially. I think I'm a scientist at heart, but I'm not a PhD or a medical doctor, so we should get that out of the way. I created this company to find medical cures for biological aging. I initially got into this to find cures to childhood disease and believe that this is the fastest route to do that. So BioViva, we're a gene therapy company, and we do gene therapies for compassionate care and consensual use. We are targeting aging as a disease. So what that means is that we're actually looking at gene therapies that appear in research and in human tissue studies, some of them in human studies, to reverse systems of aging, whether that be epigenetic changes, muscle mass changes, reversal of atherosclerotic plaques, cleaning up of DNA damage and misfolded proteins. So we're looking at gene therapies that have the most impact for everyone now.
Liz Parrish. Her name fits comfortably in the company of names like Christopher Columbus, George Washington, the Wright brothers, Neil Armstrong, Steve Jobs, and Steve Wozniak. Liz, like the rest of these people, defied the odds and refused to settle for average. Liz Parrish is a true modern-day pioneer. She is patient zero in the boldest experiment of this generation. She is the first documented person to use the gene therapies that she supports and defends so courageously. She will be living proof that those gene therapies work. Once that is done, anti-aging and disease mitigation should be available for anyone in the world who decides to participate in it. If you believe that alleviation of illness, senility, frailty, and general suffering is a good thing to pursue, then you should listen to what she has to say.
I don't have a problem with safety and efficacy. I have no problem with that. And that's why I stepped up and took this test. These therapies, okay? What I have a problem with is keeping people from access to therapeutics that may save their life. Clearly, the therapeutics that I took should have been given to somebody who is dying today. As a matter of fact, there's over 100,000 people dying today of age-related diseases. One of them should have received that. We had no ability to give that to one of them, so I took it myself to see what would happen. So, you know, I don't know what will happen to me in one day or 12 million years, but that because we study death, and I know that waiting for a cure to come down the pipeline, I would have died anyway. So that's how I feel. We're actually a team of, we're not a one-woman team. We are a team of researchers, medical doctors who back the science. We are soundly based in what we're doing. And if people want to ask, they should go to the website, they should look at the science, they should look at how many years of science we've been sitting on, science that arguably maybe isn't patentable, and maybe that's why it's not being used. We're using the scientific method to find out if it works. We're trying to get people behind testing it. I'm asking George Church and his group to come up and test my samples, and verify if there are any changes. I have a bunch of pre-blood and that we banked and tissue samples. So, you know, any of the big groups, if a group wants to come forward from, you know, Stanford, Harvard, any place like that and verify what we're doing, we would love that. If the test fails, then depending on how it fails, it may be because we didn't do enough of the therapy or whatever, and we want to prepare everyone for that. Certainly, we're excited. You can't have a more excited person. I wake up every day, I look in the mirror, I check my eyes, I check my skin, I check my waistline, I check everything. And so, you know, there's no one more excited than me. you know, where I'm, you know, willing to give everything is necessary to find out. And, you know, I guess my biggest fear is that it won't be a success and we won't have any outcome. And that would be a big sadness. But I think that it's okay because we started. And let's hope, let's roll for results. Bad or good, let's roll for some results so that we can start to get these therapeutics online for everyone as soon as possible.
What is gene therapy? It's a giant step forward for mankind. Gene therapy will heal the elderly of age-related diseases. It will increase healthy lifespan for humanity. Gene therapy is the future of medicine. It is cures, not just treatments. In sharp contrast, modern pharmaceuticals are a bunch of horrible experiments that have failed us miserably. Gene therapy will replace most of those horrible medications that just prolong suffering. But Liz is the expert. Let her explain what gene therapy is.
This is what gene therapy is. It's not very scary at all. We start with a therapeutic transgene, the gene that we either need to put in because you have a dysfunctional copy or the gene that we want to upregulate the production of the protein that it makes. We put it into a viral vector. So here we have viruses. That sounds very scary, but viruses are really good about going in and attaching to our cells and delivering their payload. With our viruses, we take out their ability to replicate. They can't actually make you sick. And then we put this transgene in, and they deliver it. They're so silly. We've outwitted them. And so they think they're going on to make more of themselves, but in fact, they're not. The gene goes in and it starts creating the protein, and what you need to know is that then changes you. It makes you healthier and better in our case. These are our viral vectors. This is the adeno-associated virus. Why we work with this is very special, okay? We work with this because it doesn't make people sick. It's very easy to work with. It's never caused related problems that they've had with gene therapy in the past. So it's not a big fear scenario. It's very effective and it actually transduces, and transduce means it puts its the gene into the cell. It transduces both dividing cells and non-dividing cells. And we have things called serotypes. And a serotype is a type of that virus that will actually target specific tissues. So we can deliver to the brain, to your skin, to your organs with different serotypes. And this is a really special technology.
So now that you have a good understanding of what gene therapy is, you're probably wondering, what is old age? Or I can tell you what it's not. It's not much of anything good. It's like a bunch of little gremlins beating your body to pieces with tiny jackhammers from the inside. It's like a time bomb with a short fuse. It's like playing a game of leapfrog from one ailment to the next. But Bill Andrews and Liz both can weigh in on this. They are both true experts in the field of aging. They can tell you what it really is and what causes it.
I'm just a guy that wants to cure aging. That's all I am. And so let me go to cell senescence. And the number one cause of cell senescence is telomere shortening. Now, telomeres are inside every cell, and we have to zoom in even further. We find that every cell contains a nucleus, and inside these nuclei are found these chromosomes. This is where your genes are that give you your hair color, your eye color, affect a lot of things about us, make us all different from one another. These are also the things that we got to shuffle all the time to adapt to a changing environment. We got to zoom in further on one of the chromosomes. A chromosome is made up, contains a long strand of DNA. It extends from one end all the way to the other. This DNA is a long string of beads. The beads are called bases. And it's the sequence of these bases that actually give you your hair color, your eye color, and everything like that. I want you to think of this long, long string of beads like a very long shoelace. And at the tip of your shoelaces are caps. These caps protect your shoelaces. While our long shoelaces, our long DNA inside our cell also have caps They're found at the very tips of our chromosome, shown in yellow, and these are the telomeres. The telomeres are the very tips of our chromosomes, just like the caps on our shoelaces. Now, this DNA is all wound up like a slinky from one end to the other because it's so big it can't fit inside a chromosome unless it's all condensed into like a slinky. But if we unravel the slinky part of the telomere, we find that a telomere is about 15,000 bases in length. A chromosome is about 100 million bases in length. A telomere is only 15,000 bases in length, at least when we're first conceived. This is where all the troubles begin, right here. Because when our cells divide, each and every time our cells divide, our telomeres get a little bit shorter by about 50 to 100 bases. I just want to let you know, what I'm going to explain right now is no longer theory. This is a well-established fact in the scientific community that everything I'm going to describe right now is actually occurring in every single one of us. But as soon as our cells divide and our telomeres start shortening, they get shorter and shorter and shorter. Remember, there's so much cell division from a single cell embryo to a newborn baby that our telomeres shorten to 10,000 bases. They shorten from 15,000 bases down to 10,000 bases before we're even born. That's okay. Your shoelaces, if the caps on your shoelaces get half that much shorter, let's say half the length, they're still okay. All right, so we're still healthy and stuff. But the problem doesn't end there, because we have a lot of growing yet to do and a lot of cell division. So as we grow up and our telomeres get shorter and shorter and shorter, when they get down to 5,000 bases, we die of old age. When the telomeres get short, our chromosomes start falling apart. When they start getting shorter, even before they get really short, they're affecting gene expression. They're causing collagen to go down. It's causing elastin to go down, to be less elastin and collagen in your cells. It's increasing enzymes that degrade these things, like collagenase and elastinase. It's doing a whole bunch of other changes. There's like 100 different biomarkers of aging that are all in question. Nobody really knows the best biomarkers of aging, but we're seeing all these things change. And they're happening when the telomeres get short.
Aging is cellular degeneration over time. And so biological aging obviously is what we're going after. We're not going after chronological aging. We can make that really clear. We want you to get really old in numbers, but not cellularly. So it's cellular degeneration over time. It's DNA damage, it's misfolded protein accumulation, it's depletion of stem cells, or actually the miscommunication between the stem cells and the rest of the body. Often we die with a lot of very good robust stem cells, but there's just no communication between the niches anymore. It's a lot of things. The DNA damage can come down to damage that happens, you know, from radiation, the sun, to damage that just comes with replication errors. So we see problems in cell signaling. We see telomere loss. We see many of these things. So I think that our definition of biological aging is very similar to other people's definition of them. It's just how to solve it.
What is normal? To me, normal is just a word that has to be redefined as things change. It was normal to walk until people started riding horses. It was normal to ride horses until people started driving cars. It was normal to die young until antibiotics were invented to fight infectious disease. It is normal right now to die old, sick, and senile. Tomorrow's new normal will be to live much longer, much healthier lives. Do you think tomorrow's new normal will feel normal to you? It has been said that death gives meaning to life. Was that meant to be a joke? Was the person who said that clinically depressed? Death gives meaning to the life of the undertaker. Living gives meaning to the lives of everyone else. All of the people in the next few clips, Robert Vredes, Ray Kurzweil, and Liz Parrish, are absolute experts at what they do. The smartest minds listen when they speak. You should too. Remember, they might be right.
My name is Robert Freitas. I'm the Senior Research Fellow at the Institute for Molecular Manufacturing. I am a nanorobot theoretician. I have a message for my fellow baby boomers. Aging is a disease. It's a curable disease.
Medical nanorobots really have the potential to extend human life more or less indefinitely, because it's very hard to imagine too many things that could terminate human life that we wouldn't be able to address with this type of technology. So what's your view about the role of death, and do we need death?
I have no patience for people who say that death gives meaning to life. I believe that life gives meaning to life. And I believe that our intellectual pursuits, our relationships with people, those things are what give the most meaning to life. And you can only experience those through life. Death is something that is an end. It's an end to life. It's an end to progress. It's an end to thoughts. It's something to be cured, not lived with.
We're going to go through a historical perspective of how we die and what we consider normal. So normal is a situational opinion. It's really important that we define that. I think that your group is actually really good at defining that, but most of the world isn't. They're a bit locked down. And if somebody says that dying of aging is normal, we take that as a fact. It's like a truth, and it just shuts people down. But normal is a situational opinion, and normal has changed over history, and we're going to look at that. So this is a quote from Thomas Hobbes in 1651, his book Leviathan, and this was him explaining what life was like in the 1600s. Okay, it was solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. And as a matter of fact, this was absolutely true. Most people died by the age of 30 of infectious disease. Okay, so here's the death records. I know this is very, very bland, but we have to actually study death to understand life, because how we die has everything to do with how we live, okay? I'm afraid you can't read this, but there was a myriad of things that people were dying of here, and they were all infectious disease, about 90%. Only 1% of persons this week in London died of aging. And so dying of aging was considered absolutely abnormal. Okay, we're going to speed forward, and we're going to look at what that looks like on a graph. This is what it looks like. Infectious disease is killing 90% of people. We have various things killing 9% of the population, and aging is killing 1%, and we don't even know what's killing them. Okay, so not very good stuff, but this is normal. And as a matter of fact, just to speed up the presentation a little bit, in 1850, when the first immunizations came around, much like how gene therapy is coming now, people rallied in the streets. They said that, you know, this was against their beliefs. They thought the government was interfering with their life, but we're going to see what the advent of antibiotics and immunizations did to help these people, to help our people, okay? These were our people. We're going to speed forward to the causes of death in 1900. We're doing so much better. This wasn't that long ago, you guys. Still, more than half of the people are dying of infectious disease. In 1900, there were 8,000 motor vehicles on the road in the U.S. That went to 8 million by 1920. We're advancing so fast. There are people who are still alive that were born before 1900 right now. They're the super centurions, and they're hanging on, and we'll see if, in fact, we can keep them around a lot longer. So we're going to speed forward to causes of death in 2010. This is some of our most relevant data to now. And we want to look at how normal has changed here. This is what we want to emphasize. So death is down to 3% from infectious disease. As a matter of fact, people consider dying of infectious disease so abnormal that you might have noticed this. When one person died in the U.S. from Ebola, it made headlines.
People might, you know, when they're 30, say, oh, I don't want to live past 95, but when they're 95, they actually want to live to 96. You know, I want to live, I think, the same reason that I believe everyone else does. People say, oh, well, death gives meaning to life because it makes life short, and therefore it gives meaning to time. Actually, what gives meaning to life is the things we can do with it. Being creative, creating music, art, poetry, having relationships with other people, being loving. We'd all like to live indefinitely. In fact, research shows that people don't want to take their lives or end their lives
unless they're suffering physical or emotional pain. And people think, oh, well, I don't want to live hundreds of years because they think of themselves living as what we today think of as a 100-year-old living for a few hundred more years. And that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about being able to overcome disease and aging. And aging really is a disease-like process. That's going to be a very profound transformation over the next 10, 15 years. Health and medicine has become an information technology. Health and medicine didn't used to be an information technology. The Genome Project gave us the software of life, and biology is an information process.
Is it better to die just to make more room on the planet for a younger person? Or is it better to live long and help build a better planet that can support more people? Is it going against God's will to live longer? Methuselah lived 969 years. Did he overstay his welcome according to God? So is it God or is it man that thinks people should die young?
So what is the world impact? I think that you guys know what the world impact is here. It's big. But how do you get your arsenal against people who are going to give you trouble with this, okay? Fertility and increased lifespan. People will say the world is going to be overpopulated. It's going to be so horrible. We're all going to be gnawing each other's legs off. Okay. Here's something really fascinating, okay? In corners of the world that you have never seen, regardless of race, religion, culture, as lifespan goes up, fertility goes down. It everywhere. There's never been a place that we've looked at that this doesn't happen. So if you look at this chart in 1960, you see how many children people were having compared to the country they were in. And then in 2012, how much that's come down. And it continues to decline. Japan is at negative growth. I don't want overpopulation either. Actually, you know, my next crusade would be the environment after I solve this problem. So, you know, I intend to be around for a while. So the economy, does this touch anyone here? He's saying, have you thought about aging more slowly? You know, your 401k is in terrible shape. Okay, we can't actually afford what's happening right now. We have more and more people will live to the age of 120, and yet they're retiring at 65. And they need to retire. They're retiring with illness, the inability to work. If we can put these people back to work in young, youthful, healthy bodies, it would be so good for the environment. And the economy and everything else, because we'll be working on new problems that will solve issues that we haven't solved in the past. I believe it was Bill Andrews' book that he said that actually with all the money the government would save, having all of these diseases eradicated, that everyone could be paid by the government to take a 10-year retirement in between starting the second half of your life. And this is saying that we would live to 120. You know, we work really hard to keep our message that we're just trying to make healthy people. And then, of course, you know, you're the group who actually understands a very important question. If you're healthy, what do you die of? You don't. You know, by the definition of the World Health Organization, no one is healthy on this planet. And actually, we'd like to hold the World Health Organization to their definition. We want to demand that they stand by that. Because in principle, we need to do some very big fundamental changes. The government this year is going to spend approximately $13 billion on battling the symptoms of aging, with only $2 billion of that dollars going to aging research itself. That's a problem. And as a matter of fact, this doesn't account for the trillions of dollars that they spend treating people with disease and paying for, you know, people who are infirmed and on palliative care.
Do you have confidence in the AMA and the FDA? Are you sure you want them making all the decisions about your health care? It's good to have confidence in your country and your government. It's only good to have confidence in the people running the government when they are serving your best interests, though. After watching the following video clip from the movie Doctored, ask yourself how much confidence you have in the people who run the AMA and the FDA, and then grab a copy of Doctored and watch it. You'll be shocked at what you find.
The biggest contradiction in our culture today is calling medicine healthcare. We spend $2.7 trillion per year, and we're incredibly sick as a culture.
I don't think any of us would have a problem spending that much money if we got results, but we're not getting the results for that investment.
I feel worse now than I did 2.5 years ago when I started seeing, I'm told, some of the best people in the business.
Nobody has had the good sense to say, Mr. Morris, we don't know what's wrong with you.
I went to numerous doctors and my husband said, what do we do now? And she looked at him and she goes, she was sending me home to die.
We're seeing patients that truly have had the best healthcare money can buy. They've been to every specialist and they're sort of missing this important piece.
Alternative treatment has not been allowed to flourish in the medical community. It's basically been stifled.
The AMA's goal and objective was to contain and eliminate the profession of chiropractic. And they did it in the most clandestine way possible.
Put in drug station, they were trying to put me out of circulation, put me to prison for life. Whenever you have the best results, then we are most viciously attacked by our peers.
I have a report from my family physician which tells how well I am doing. My tumors are leaving my body. Now the FDA is saying to me, no, your doctor is a criminal. He should be put in jail and he needs to be shut down. This is criminal.
All these things interact and have impact on individual people's lives.
He sat us down and he says, your son has cancer.
They did all these things to try to find some cancer, and every one of those tests came out negative. Yet the doctor still kept saying, well, we still expect you to come, you know, Thursday morning to start chemotherapy.
We have patients that have absolutely no benefit from the surgery we provide.
I had a man come into my office the other day who had 8 back surgeries. He didn't need one of them.
People who had back pain, a manageable problem, they get put on this drug, and next thing you know, they substitute their back pain for a drug addiction.
I almost feel guilty because I'm, let's face it, a junkie.
The pharmaceutical industry doesn't have any respect for you. They're talking about which drug whore to get to promote their products. They have no respect for their whores.
GSK Salesforce bribed physicians to prescribe GSK products.
Every year, 125,000 people die from properly prescribed prescription drugs.
It's a cost of doing business, but lives are lost.
The time is now. People are dying now. The technology is here. When we are old and sick and dying anyway, people need a right to try law. If you are dying anyway, why shouldn't you have the right to try a new therapy that could save your life? The clock is ticking. As a world community, we have to act quickly to stop human suffering. Don't ever vote for anyone in any election that don't support your right to try. The powers that be work in mysterious ways. They are not above distributing outlandish propaganda that leads people to believe that positive change is actually negative change. There are people at higher levels of society that do not care about your future. It's up to us, one and all, to break from the herd. We are not cattle or sheep. It is time to hit the streets, airwaves, and the internet, and let it be known that change is awesome when it's change for the better. Rights that we enjoy have been paid for in blood. They are not cheap, disposable conveniences. The right to try is a right we should demand, and we should not settle for anything less than that.
I want to try a bit flip in your mind and that of the group here. It's really easy for us to point out the potential dangers. That's what our evolutionary brain does. We do really well. We find the danger way before it happens, but we ignore the good. So we say, oh, Dick Cheney's pacemaker, and forget the millions of people with pacemakers that are benefiting from it. And you know, the flip side is, and this, I have this battle with the FDA all the time, right? The FDA's mindset is, oh, we can't allow that drug or that technology because of it might be dangerous. And so all you're measuring in the circumstance is the potential deaths that could be caused if it was made legal. You don't measure all the deaths that do occur because it isn't tried. And we have this perverse situation that drives me up the, I would be using a four-letter expletive starting with F if I could right now, wall. And it really irks me that this risk aversion we take costs lives. And I can't even take the risks if I want as an individual. And I hate this fact, how risk adverse we've become. And the challenge is that when the government starts telling me I can't try things because I want to take the risk with my life to try these things. So this negative mindset that we have about, oh, what if this happens? What if this happens? Yes, all this could happen. But the fact of the matter is we forget that technology is the one force that has transformed this world. Right? 150 years ago, the average lifespan was like 30. Right? 30. Think about, try that on for those of you above 30 or just below 30. You know, the human lifespan has more than doubled. The per capita income for every nation over the last 100 years has more than tripled. The cost of food has dropped 13-fold. Energy has dropped 20-fold. Transportation has dropped 100-fold. We are living during the most peaceful time ever in human history. Right? You wouldn't know that watching the Crisis News Network, whose job it is to take every murder, every warfare, and bring it to your eyes on television over and over and over again. Why? Because that's how they make money. Do not be fooled by this. Their job is to deliver your eyeballs, your prefrontal cortex, to their advertisers. And they do that because you as a human, me as a human, we pay 10 times more attention to negative news than positive news. It's evolutionary. That's what kept us alive in the days where a rustle in the leaves could be a tiger and not the wind. And that all that negative news really depresses us. And you let them. I don't watch the news. I step over the newspaper. I get my news only from the sources I need that are relevant to me. Your mindset matters. And if you're looking at the downside of all the things all the time, it's going to depress living daylights out of you.
Well, I think that human rights are a huge issue here. I think that, you know, the right to try, the right to use, experimental therapies for yourself, regardless of the situation you're in, but especially if you're terminally ill. You know, right now in the United States, in some states, you do have right to try access, but it's only for drugs that have gotten to a certain level of safety and efficacy. And then you have to get a drug manufacturer to actually make them. And, you know, doing all of this while you're dying of a disease is actually quite difficult. And it's why a lot of people die without the right to try or the right to use. And a lot of people have actually died in this country. That then their families have gone on to be behind legislation that helps other families while they're waiting for access to these medicines. I want people to learn more about biology. I want them to learn more about their bodies. And I want them to really take control of that and to tell the powers that be that they should have the right to do with their body as they see fit. We want people to be safe. The FDA has a really important job of making sure that uninformed people don't take therapies that may in fact kill them or be unhealthy or have things like antifreeze in them, which is essentially how they got started. But we want them to be informed all the way around, and not just because one company could afford to get through a matter of testing. You know, the money and safety and efficacy should not go hand in hand. I've had this conversation with many people. They say, well, it's expensive and, you know, and it costs this much to get through the FDA. And I'm not sure why costs and safety and efficacy are part of one conversation. I think they should be part of two very different conversations.
Liz Parrish and her colleagues have done their part by producing these therapies. Now it's time for us to do our part by sharing information about them. Now listen as Arby DeGray and Liz tell you how to go about promoting these new therapies. Take this to heart. Pick up the ball and run with it. You can be a huge part of the most innovative movement of modern times.
We need more people to be effective crusaders, to be going out persuading the world that this needs to be done and it needs to be done urgently. So these are the kinds of concerns that I spend my life trying to allay when I speak to the media or to the general public or even to other scientists in most countries. They say, oh dear, if we didn't have aging, where would we put all the people? They'll say, oh dear, if we develop this technology, there will be even greater inequality in the world because only the rich will be able to afford them. And won't it be boring living so long? I don't think I need to explain to you people why these objections are silly. But they are silly, and you need to be able to explain to other people really well why they're silly. One needs to make sure that people understand that this is just medical research, same as any other medical research. You need to demystify it. In order to stop people thinking this way and start getting people to think this way about a post-aging world, you need to use the right language. You need to be positive. You need to tell people, no, you should not be worried about there being too many people, because other technologies are going to mean it's okay to have a lot of people. If we have more renewable energy, if we have better agriculture, then we can have more people with less environmental impact. What we should be thinking about is the suffering that exists today when we don't have the cure for these diseases and disabilities. When we can bring those things under medical control, we won't have any Alzheimer's disease. We won't have any cancers of old age. We won't have atherosclerosis and heart attacks and strokes. That's the way that we need people to be thinking. And of course, it's not just the diseases. It's the vitality that comes with being youthful, being physically and mentally just like a young adult. People like that will not be bored. They will be contributing wealth to society still. So everyone will be more prosperous. And that's why everybody will have access to these therapies, even if they cannot pay for them themselves. Today, 100,000 people die every day worldwide from aging. That's two-thirds of all deaths. In the industrialized world, it's something like 90% of all deaths. And of course, most of those people die after a long period of decline and disease and decrepitude and dependence and general misery. That's not good. It's a really big problem. Finally, it's important to understand that we do not have the right to make a decision about the lives of people in the future. Maybe there will be new technologies that will alleviate some of these problems. Maybe there won't. We cannot know, and therefore, we need to give humanity of the future the option, the choice whether to use these technologies or not. If we don't develop these technologies, these medicines, then they will not have that option. And we will be condemning them to an unnecessarily painful and unnecessarily early death.
It would be a verb. We just have to do it. And that's what our company is all about. It's about really changing how we do healthcare. It's changing how we motivate people to get involved now. It has a lot to do with pioneering spirits, about encouraging you to think about life a lot differently, encouraging people to take the risks now, whether that's financial risks or social risks, to get out there and say that this is what we should be doing. Or maybe even for people in compassionate care scenario, taking the risks to try a therapy now that could reverse their disease and change the future for mankind.
An elderly gentleman said to his doctor, "Doc, I feel like my whole body's just falling apart." The doctor responded, "That's normal. You're suffering from the disease of old age. The old man asked, "Is there anything we can do about it?" The doctor answered, "Sure, we can treat you with a bunch of drugs that might extend your life by a couple of miserable years. Or we can treat you with gene therapy and double your health and lifespan, and you will be young right up to the day you die. Now, which treatment would you prefer?" The old man responded sadly, "I guess I'll take the miserable couple of extra years. I'm certainly not entitled to live a longer, healthier life." Now, here's the question. Do you want to be that old man? Which treatment would you choose? Do you want normal or do you want better? If you want better, then join the conversation. Join the new blog at singularityplus.com. Get involved and share. Share this video and others like it every way that you can.
I would like everyone to think of their future in a really different way. I'd like to think of your life as being more unlimited. I'd like you to think of what you would like to do for work for the second half of your life. I would like you to think of how you can help expedite these sciences, whether you can get financially involved, whether you can share our information on Facebook and social media sites, whether you can tell your legislator that, you know, you're looking into gene therapy and that you want a mandate for people to be able to use that, whether you want to look at the human right aspect of your ability to do with your body as you see fit, if you want to look into diseases and start reaching out to communities, asking hospitals, research hospitals, if they're offering things like gene therapy, you know, really start pushing towards this, because it affects you. It actually affects everyone. That is the most interesting thing about the platform of aging. There's no one who runs outside of that. You know, if you think that you're healthy for your age, I mean, I think that that's fantastic. But, you know, look at some of our slides of what healthy for your age is for an 87-year-old compared to a 27-year-old. You know, if your doctor gives you a clean bill of health, that actually doesn't, that means for your age. And what we want to do is we want to take that back and get you climbing mountains and running around. And we don't want your care in the future to look like palliative care. We want it to look like care for yourself.
Hey, baby boomers, remember the 60s? How did it feel to actually stand together and make a difference? You stopped the Vietnam War. If you did that, you can do this. All it takes is the strength of your participation and the weight of your name to get this done. Stand up, be counted, make a difference, and do it now. Isn't it time for us to wake up from our long slumber and just do something? Something real? If we are breathing, we can do something. If we want to keep breathing, we better do something fast.
It's been a long road, getting from there to here. It's been a long time, but my time is finally near. And I can feel a change in the wind right now. Nothing's in my way, and they're not gonna hold me down no more. No, they're not gonna hold me down. I've got faith of the heart. I'm going where my heart will take me. I've got faith to believe I can do anything. I've got strength of the soul. And no one's gonna bend or break me. I can reach and start. I've got faith. I will see my dream come alive and alive.